So I was saying something fascinating, but I forgot.
You like here better than the artist.
Thank you, thank you. That's the main point. So you came to a great school, and I was happy to be here because I learned a lot of the basics. I learned just things that I was amazed they didn't teach at the Art Institute. Like, I could get into life drawing class since I was a first-year student. They teach things like I did a color wheel here. I learned all my color stuff. I learned where shadows fall. I learned perspective. I learned lettering. I just learned all the basic nuts and bolts. I mean, this is before Photoshop and computers. It was just everything was on paper. But I had a fantastic time learning all the basics. And then once you learn the basics, you can go off in your own style or your own ideas, your own whatever. But if you don't have a solid footing on knowing what you can do with art and the rules behind what you're painting, you're just going to flounder and produce mediocre stuff. But if you have a solid footing, which the American Academy of Art gave me, you're off on the right track. Okay, that's me. I thought someone might have been lurking behind my head as I could. I'm also promoting a new book of my artwork, and there have been many fine books before my book. That was one book. It's almost as popular, I think, as mine will be. Another book. Let's see. All from my library. We're building, we end with my book, I don't want to give it away, but it's her own particular religion, which is very fascinating. It's also a very intriguing title and off-putting at the same time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Aaron, can I have my copy back, please? When you're done. Hobos get such a bad rap, but if you make them sex hobos, they're much more intriguing. Jimmy, what is it, Jerry and Jimmy the pharmacist? Yeah. Jimmy and Jerry only remember the first 10 minutes visiting the pharmacist, but... Another great book. Should I give away the answer? I'll let you read the book on your own. Oh, and then, who has goosebumps? Whose nipples are fully erect? I know mine. So, I have this giant career retrospective. It's like 300 pages, which I'm thrilled to have coming out from Last Gasp. I'm doing a signing tomorrow at a place called Rotofuji, which is like a toy store gallery. So, you're all, as part of the, you're all required to come. I believe your grade depends on it.
Yes, we'll be grading them.
Right. We're starting from the beginning. This is actually some of my schoolwork from I do not know when, but apparently me drawing nude people was not a new thing. So there's a self-portrait. I'm not sure how that genitalia works, but I seem to be happy about it. And you can often see me in my own backyard in pretty much the same state of attire. That is another portrait of me, and interesting things behind that one. I still can't spell. I call in the type, I don't know if you can make it up, but it's self-picture because I had no idea how to spell portrait. And also, I couldn't draw my mouth and chin right, so I decided, what the hell, I'll put a brick wall in front of me. And you're going to see many brick walls in the future of my illustrations, and now you'll know why. Like, that left arm, why is it behind a brick wall? This was high school, and in the art class, I have a sense of the macabre, apparently, because our art teacher, I think she had the scissors, the Elmer's glue, the little bit of plant life, and the pencil in there, I think. One of the things I added, and I'm pretty sure it's the head, it was not a bad display, but I don't know what my high school teachers thought about me. This was a piece of art done here at the American Academy of Art, and one thing we had to do, I don't know if you do it anymore, but we had to put our art, the teachers would decide what art goes on the wall for everybody to take a look at, but the downside of your art going on the wall, Mr. Shapiro would pick two pieces to keep in the American Academy of Art collection, so I never put my art on the wall. I just always stuck it right in my portfolio because I knew that someday my art would be amazingly valuable and treasured by museums everywhere, so to give it, you know, to have it stuck in this, you know, iffy environment, no thank you. I mean, really. I most of my stuff's across the street, just like two blocks over on the side. This was just after the American Academy of Art, always trying to, you know, get work, so I had a new business card like every week. And I had a very 80s style. It's all flying triangles and zigzags and nonsense. This was a job I got while going to the American Academy of Art, because I was always trying to get work, and that's one reason I left after three semesters, that I was making a living drawing, and I figured, you know, I'm making a living now, isn't that kind of the point? So this was done for Playboy. So my first piece for Playboy, I probably have done maybe, I don't know, a couple hundred paintings for them. And interestingly enough, they paid me $250 for that spot illustration in 1981, and they still pay $250 for a spot illustration. So it seems like editorial work is not, you're not going to make a killing, at least I'm not. That was also a very early job. The art looks better. It looks a little odd projected on the screen, but take my word, it looks a lot better. This was also one of my first pieces. This was, I would regularly, as a kid, go to New York and show my portfolio around. This was before anybody had a website, anybody emailed artwork off. This is, you had a portfolio of like 10 images, and you would drag it to someone and put it before their eyes, and they would leaf through it and then say, thank you for coming. And you're hoping for thank you coming, here's your first job. It was usually just thank you for coming. So I would bring my portfolio to New York and show my stuff around. And one of my first jobs was at Heavy Metal magazine. This was a wraparound cover. I don't know, Heavy Metal magazine is still out, but it was kind of a big deal in the 80s. And I learned a little bit about negotiating there, because the editor, Julie Simmons Lynch, looked at this and said, oh, I can use this for a cover. And she said, how much do you want? And I didn't know. And she said, well, I'll give you $500. And I said, great. And then she sighed and shook her head and said, no, you're supposed to ask for $1,000. And then I say $750, and then we agree on that. So I so she took pity on my naivety and bumped me up to $750. This was also while going to the American Academy of Art. There was a company called Charlton Comics. And I always wanted to draw comics. That was my dream, just comics, comics, comics. Until I learned how much work comics are, how little they pay, and suddenly it was like advertising art, advertising art, advertising art. So that was a self-portrait back then when I had beautiful flowing golden locks. I have to... I'm all right now. So, and Charlton, the trick was they would like people ask people at art schools because they didn't pay. So you would just do covers and they would send you like 12 free copies and you were just extremely excited that, look at this, my art's on a comic book cover. So I probably did about 8 of them back when going to art school. Well, my big thing, well, big for me, was doing a graphic novel where I got to do 64 pages of a comic book, and that was called The World of Ginger Fox, and that's the cover. That's a page. Quiz, cover or page?
Cover.
Cover or page? That's very good. And that's a more recent one. So I still love doing comics, even though I do them infrequently, and that was done for the fun of it. It was a comic called Poodle Man. So just to show you something a little more recent. This was, because a theme to whatever I'm going to be saying is you have to draw well to get work, or you have to draw well to get your second job. But you have to get your first job, you have to just promote and just shove your art down everybody's throat. And you have to figure all of you are in a big heap, and the one who crawls to the top is the winner, and everybody else is a loser. So one of you is going to be a winner. You just have to crawl faster and get your stuff more out there and just knock on more doors and just make yourself a little more well known. The reason I got this job at the Entertainment Weekly is I sent a picture of my ex-wife when she was pregnant with her first child, and I had a picture of her, and I had a pleading letter about how much I need work. And so, apparently the afternoon the art director got the job, she gave me a call and gave me this job. The downside is that was the only job I ever got for Entertainment Weekly. So, but that's, it got me the job, because I'm sure no one else that day sent a picture of their pregnant spouse. Just more miscellaneous work. It's fun doing caricatures. I mean, I I can't remember the actresses' names now, but there are a few of them. That was for Cosmo Girl magazine, I think. This was, there was a local men's clothing store in Chicago called IK Gun, and I always had fun. This is, again, you know, early 90s, late 80s, to the hilt. But it was fun. I love drawing. Things I like drawing are, well, I like drawing people. I love drawing hair, because I love drawing all the folds and clumps and curves it takes. I love drawing clothing, because just the folds and how clothes drape, it's so much fun to get it right, like hands. I mean, it's to get things working and flowing and interesting and just make every object just well drawn is a big kick. And so it was fun doing these ads for IK Don. And you get to see, the next picture, you get to see the progression of my hair, which is going to be a big treat. I was full-blown mullet in the early 90s, so I had the hair was rapidly going away, but it was going away down my back. It was like retreating. But I got to have a billboard. It was the smallest billboard ever known to man, but it still counts as a billboard. And I'm going to show you a series of pencils, too. I do a lot of like CD covers when I can. Most of them are for like smaller bands, for getting $500 to do it. But this was a job for a gentleman called, he was like a country rap artist that had one album that went nowhere, as far as I know, unless you're all DF Dub fans. Yes, no. So this was a job for Warner Brothers, and when someone's paying you, like, I don't know what they pay me, $3,000 or $4,000, then you want to make the extra effort, like whatever, it's yes, 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 yes. If you're getting $500, it's yes, yes. No, thank you. So I did a bunch of pencil sketches for the cover. This is one of them. A little closer. Yeah, the video for DF Dub was so ludicrous. He was just singing with that, and they hired like 80 models to jump around him like he was the shit, and it was just kind of sad. So that was that drawing. Then it was just him with three girls on the back of his pickup, because he's so awesome. And that was another little cute one I drew, which I like better. But they went with this one, so here's the inked version. And it's not the most picked, I mean, I don't really think this drawing's great, but it just, I had a bunch of copies of the pencil, so I thought I'd bring it along. And here's how it looked colored, where I colored it in Photoshop. So I loved when Photoshop started, because I didn't have to do full paintings anymore. I could just do a black and white drawing and then color it in Photoshop, which took 1/10 the time, and no aggravation. There was no paint spilling. There was no cats on my table knocking over my water. There was no airbrush spitting. There was no me throwing the airbrush on the ground and stomping on it and having to drive to Dick Click, buy a new airbrush and driving back home again. It just saves so much time. And then you just push send and they get it. And if they want, Mitch, we love it, but we don't like all those colors. You just go over there, click, 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 click. Changed. Here's more behind the scenes. My son and I are posing for what you'll see next, which is it came from the garage, so a bunch of zombies. Milling around, that's fun. I always like drawing the rod and things. This is more painterly when they ask for that type of style. This is for Rolling Stone, and I love painting. It just takes longer, but it's still a lot of fun. Another pencil, this is for, I think, Village Voice. It was about being a starving artist. So here's your starving artist. And I love big-eyed kids, that type of melancholy. Here's in color again. Very easy to do, because it's, you do the black and white drawing, you scan it, and then you just color it. More pencil drawing, I love burlesque stuff, and every year I get to do the Windy City burlesque poster, so there's a pencil drawing, and there's the finished one. And if you ever go to Kiss Kiss Cabaret, which is a great show, Friday nights at the Greenhouse Theater, these are like 8-foot-high banners, they were going to them. Cut the heads out so you could peek your face through and have your picture taken, but this side they didn't, so just hanging up there. They look nice. One of my favorite jobs of doing a series for Warner Brothers, which never got used. They were the idea was they were going to merchandise them on like lunchboxes, towels, who knows what. And so I did about 50 pencil drawings, and they picked like maybe their favorite 12. And they knew what they were getting, so they couldn't have been surprised since they approved the pencils. But here's one called Yogi Loves Pie. Here's Penelope Pit Stop, which came out well. I'm only showing you the ones that came out well. There's plenty of art that did come out well, which is at home. And it's just fun doing, I love doing whatever, well, I love doing whatever I can get, but doing stuff for plays is always enjoyable. Posters are a lot of fun. And I did a poster for my daughter when she was at Peterson School. This is for the high school play Cinderella. And speaking of fun stuff to do, I always like Jan Terry. Jan Terry has these amazing videos she shot in the early 90s on YouTube, and each one of them has like 20 million hits. And when sometimes you think, like, what art do you want to do? What art would make you happy? And I'm thinking, I want to do a Jan Terry poster, because she might appreciate it. So I like emailed Jan and Terry, said, you know, I'd love to do a poster for you, here's art. I'm not like some crazy guy that's just emailing you out of the blue. And then Jan and Terry wrote me back this very confused letter. And so I was ready for this. I'm spoiled sometimes where I get like, you know, what, you're gonna do a poster for me for free? And blah, 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 I can't wait it. But she didn't respond, so, because I wanted her input, like, what would be the ideal poster for you? And what, how can I do to make this discreet? So it would be just, you know, your iconic image. So I had my daughter pose, and she stuck a pillow under her shirt and gave me, we had a toy guitar, and she did a gesture, so I did a pseudo-Jan Terry poster. And I went to the concert and got to meet Jan, and Jan is, you know, obviously saying, get this guy off me. So I found that in real life, Jan is wonderful but confused, so I knew there was never going to be a connection anyhow, so I was just happy I went ahead and did it even without her permission. Wonderful, but we weren't on the same wavelength. And more burlesque stuff. A friend of mine, Joe Black. Poster for John Waters' tour for speaking engagements. Roller derby posters are always fun. So mostly my jobs now are, they've kind of slacked off the big paying jobs, which I would love to get. I would love to do an ad campaign for some cigarette company where I'm getting $1 million, but I'm not. So I'm getting a lot of the smaller paying jobs, which I enjoy more, and I get a lot more creative freedom, which are doing things for bands, or posters for roller derby, or burlesque, or, you know, on and on. Some of my self, again, what do I want to do? And I said, well, I want to do a series of black light posters. So I went ahead and just did a bunch on my own and had them printed up, and I've been selling them. This is one of the four. It was called Don't Be a Hater. So everybody's laughing at him because he got caught in the trap. And I had a foray into doing men's magazines illustrations. So for one reason is I just got a couple jobs doing work for the New York Times, and that's very prestigious and sounds fantastic on your resume. And I really wanted my resume to say, he has done art from the New York Times to Jugs Magazine. So I sent my art to Jugs Magazine, and they said yes. So I did about 7 drawings for Jugs. Jugs is for the aficionado of the large-breasted woman. And this is one of the pieces. And my stuff there has not been women with their ankles behind their heads. It's been very lighthearted and fun in the 50s kind of stuff. And this is where I strut a little bit. Yeah, I've done some covers for Newsweek magazine. Newsweek was an actual magazine, and now it's online, so kind of I can't strut as much if we're still being published. But back then, it was a fantastic job because you got like $8,000 to do a cover, and then they printed up like 8 million copies. So you got to be in your own head at least, something special. So here's one of them. There's another one. And they, doing stuff here, I'll show you. Like this one was going to be in a whole different style. It was gonna be in a comic book style. They wanted the Roy Lichtenstein, which is like an easy reference point. But they changed their minds 2 days in. You usually got like 5 days to get it done. They gave you the idea and you, boom, you just don't talk to anybody. You just sit down and draw for 5 days. And 2 days in, they had a change of direction. They wanted a more painterly image. So they said, you know, Mitch, the job died, and we have to give it to somebody else. And of course, I stepped in and said, I can handle it easily. And they let me continue, so I did it this style. This is, we're segueing into, I love doing gallery work too, because I have a lot of, I mean, I love getting paid. You have to get paid, otherwise you're living on the street and you don't have art supplies. So it's kind of hard to continue in your career. So, but along with doing commercial art, I do a lot of gallery shows. Like 2 years ago, I had like 8 shows, which were tremendously fun. I had one in Osaka, Nashville, Mexico City, Miami, and 2 other places that I forget, but it's just a big treat when you get to show off all your work. And one reason, the downside is, if I'm being completely straight, is one reason I could have 8 shows, that the art did not really sell that well. So I could keep on moving it from one gallery to the next. If they had sold that, it would have been 1 gallery show that year, and I couldn't rattle off a whole list of places. But they never used this cover for Newsweek. I think that was the year that President Clinton was having sex with Monica Lewinsky, so they were on every cover for the whole year. So they were getting bumped. But I turned it into a piece of, you know, quotation mark, fine art. So I made it about Christ coming back and everybody thinking about their sins before they get whisked off to hell or redemption. And this kind of ties into fine art because I put on a bunch of gallery shows with a friend of mine, Beth, and one of our highlights was doing a show. I don't know if you know Tura Sutana or the film Faster Pussycat Kill Kill. If you haven't seen it, go see it. I'm sure it's streaming somewhere. But it's fantastic, so we just got to have Tura come into town, do a whole show devoted to her, so it's been fun, besides participating in shows, actually putting them on. And with Chicago, you really get the feeling that instead of just being a participant, you can be someone that decides to put on an event, decide to be someone that can just throw it out there and have people come and look at it, and which is a big thrill. More pseudo-fine art. More fine art. Fine art / nude women, who's to say, but more of the same. This is 2 versions of that one. One is, this one's like 3 by 3 feet and it's covered in like glitter and jewels and resin and everything. It's just a big fun mess. And then, I used to do full paintings all the time, and then this was a very emotionally releasing because I was going through a divorce at the time, so I got to do a bunch of paintings about getting divorced. So instead of my head blowing up, I got to release some of that on the canvas, which was great because I always enjoyed painting, just painting fun stuff. But it was nice that art like took on a whole new level where it actually was meaningful to me, where I actually had things that were in my head that I had to get out, as opposed to I had to get out because I was getting paid, or I had to paint because I was doing a gallery show, I had to fill up the walls. This is like art that was gonna like just throw up whatever was going on with me. So this is relating to getting divorced. And here was another one related to getting divorced. And showing some of the behind the scenes stuff. Like this was a Richard Linder drawing, which I loved a lot. It's I think he did it in the late 50s, but I always loved collage, so like I stuck a lot of little tributes to him in this. And some of the other stuff, it's like old greeting cards, just to show you what went into the painting. And the image of the, look how fast I am now. There I am. The image of the crawling gentleman was taken. I used to love buying magazines that were called Creepy and Eerie way back in the 70s, but they always had very gory, you know, stuff for kids to look at. And I always loved this drawing of this crawling person that was like melting on one side. So right after I got that issue as a kid, I did my own version of it. And then since I love that image so much, you know, I put it again to symbolize a lot of the, you know, misery I was going through. Now I'm on to tattoos. One thing, and I'm sorry, I repeated the second from the right twice. I'll fix that in future talks. But one way I make a living too, which is hopefully going to turn into a better living, first of all, I love it. I love tattoos. I love drawing tattoo flash, because you're making these very iconic images that be very simple, and they should be very clever, and they should be very clean and lean. And here's an example of one image which I thought turned out well. It was No Worries, I've Got 9 Lives, and a cat smoking and drinking. And it was a very cute cat. And that's what you, at least what I'm going for. It's like something that's great as a tattoo, but also it can be on a lighter, it can be on a t-shirt, it can be on everything. So if it's on everything, instead of one paycheck, I'm getting lots and lots of paychecks in the mail, and I can just sleep in. And then wake up and the mailman comes. But this is, it's always a treat too when people get my work tattooed, and it's, you know, it's not just my work, then it's my work, the tattoo was for it, and the person picking it out, because they make changes and they have decision making too. I've put out 3 sets of Tattoo Flash, and the sets usually consist of 12 pages that have, you know, multiple designs on it. This is from my second set, just to show you how a page, I'm sure most of you have been to tattoo shops, you look at the walls and that's on the walls. So either you can pick an existing design or, you know, get the artist to make up your own. Just more incorporation where I've done the tattoo type of art, but this is a logo for a company. More recent stuff I'm working on. You just try to make it simple. Here's a little, if your little pet died, here's a little tattoo for you. They're very cute. But I love drawing the stuff I'm working on. Like I said, I'm working on my new set now. Oh, there's a tattoo style for Michelle Damore, who's a burlesque dancer in Chicago. And there's, that book came out a few years ago from Last Gasp, who also published my new book. Have I mentioned my new book? It's coming out tomorrow. To give you an example of where I'm trying to milk these tattoo designs is, and these have already come out, like on decks, on lockets, on lighters, on plates, on t-shirts, on stickers, on jewelry, on coasters, on magnets, on wherever I can slap them on, and as many places as possible, I'm completely for. Sell out is a compliment. I want to sell this stuff over and over and over and over and over to the end of time. It's like Peter Mack sells his stuff, or Ruben, what Thomas Kincaid. It's all good. And I have a line of shoes coming out too from Tuck, just to give you an example of where I've been merchandising my art, and that's going to be at the premiere of that is coming out in March at a place called Broken Cherry on North Avenue. And luckily, I'm getting to marry that model, so that's my, I ended on a high note. That's, what's the standing ovation? That wasn't even a minute. But I'm happy to answer questions, too. So if you have any follow-up things. Oh, yes? Well, all the tattoo lettering is hand lettering, and a lot of that was all hand lettered. Okay. And hand lettering is a lot of fun. It's just, usually if I'm in a rush, I use the font, but if I have a little bit of time, I'd much rather do my own lettering. So you get a lot more distinctive stuff, and it looks, always looks better.
Do you find yourself having the same clients, or do you just have various clients throughout?
I find I get a lot of the same clients, because when I'm working with a client, someone that's paying me, I make sure I'm the most cooperative, easygoing person that is yes to everything. I'm always on time. I'm always doing the best I can. And if they want changes, I never fuss. I never complain, because what does it matter? I'm still going to make the changes anyhow. And when people find you easygoing and to work with, they're going to say, oh, we got changes, but we can throw an extra $500 your way, or we're going to come to give you the next job, or we're going to recommend you to someone else. So it can't, because when I was younger, I was, if you think of full of myself now, I was really full of myself, or I knew how things should, I knew more than the art director, so I would like voice my opinion more. Now, when someone's paying me, I have no opinion. It's just whatever you want. Fantastic. So, and because I divide them, when I'm getting paid, is what they want. When I had that outlet for gallery work and my tattoo flash, where I do exactly what I want. So it makes it easier. Yes?
What promotional tools have you found the best to get more new clients for yourself?
Well, before this new book, I self-published 2 books of my artwork, which I felt were very good to send out to clients and prospective clients, because I used to send a lot of flyers and business cards. And those get thrown away pretty easily. But when I self-published this, like 2 books, they were like 90 pages of my artwork, and people are inclined to keep books. So they would always have them in the bookshelf or keep it in their studio or keep it at the ad agency. And that was very helpful. And I also sold the books through bookstores. And so I made all my money back, but you had a great promotional piece. And nowadays, you know, I'm doing, you know, all the social media stuff like everybody else and just milking that as much as I possibly can, and still doing the old school stuff like putting up flyers and mailing out things occasionally. So it's just trying to do things that are interesting that people like to look at and are curious about and would like to attend or would like to, you know, look at.
Do
That's it? Oh, yes?
You live here in Chicago?
Yes, I live on the north side.
And if you get a client in, say, California, how do you handle that? Do you like Skype them? Do you go out, see them face to face?
No, and it's like even when I lived in Chicago and would do a job like at Playboy, I would like take the train down. They discuss the job. I drive back, show them, come back downtown, show them the pencils, drive back, come back down, show them, give them the finished artwork. And now it's just people call me or just email me, and then I just email out pencils, and they approve or make changes, and I just email out the finished art. So it's, there's no Skyping, there's no flying, there's no nothing. It's just exchanging emails. Because on my website, too, I show like the different types of styles I have, like the full-on paint, the more tattoo flash, the more cartoony, the, you know, maybe there are three more, and they look at those and say they like the style, or they'll look at past pieces I've done to give me a reference point of what they're looking for. Yes?
Did you have any specific artists that you used for your traditional art for your tattoo flash? Or was it just all of traditional art, traditional tattoo?
Yes, it's always been just, I just love the old school traditional artwork. I mean, and you realize why they did the art that way, because it completely works. And I wanted to, and of course now with tattoos, you can, you know, recreate the Mona Lisa on someone's back, and that's fantastic, but I wanted my stuff to just, could only be tattoos. I mean, when you look at it, you're not gonna mistake it for something else. It's flash, it's tattoo design. So I love that, I've just learned, and I tattooed briefly. I did about 8 tattoos to 8 people's regret. So I learned even more, like, good God, why are there so many lines in my drawing? So I just learned to even, like, break it down. Because when I design a tattoo, I'm thinking of it as if the tattooist has, like, you know, 10 sailors on leave waiting to get their tattoo. They're just knocking them out. I didn't want to make it some long, blown-out thing, but I wanted the real work to be in how can I make this really creative and distinctive, where I'm not just drawing 2 cherries, or just a pinup, or just something that's been done to the end of time already. How can I put my own spin on it, but yet have that real simple quality, old school flash feel?
Mm-hmm. When you're doing comics, how'd you get into that certain field?
I would, as a youngster, I would go to comic book conventions and show my work to editors. I would. Again, when I was in New York, I would stop at the comic book companies to show my artwork. I would mail my stuff off, and comics were a lot bigger back then. I mean, they get smaller and smaller every year, and pretty much comics seemed to be just a launching ground to selling your character to something more profitable. But I just love storytelling in comics and laying out pages and making the story flow, and a lot of my favorite artists drew comic books. So I guess nowadays you would just look up editors that are working at different comic book companies and just mail them your artwork, or email it, or have a website where people would go to see what work you're putting out, or put out your own comic book. I mean, you can print up stuff, you know, nothing to tell you, but you can print up stuff cheaply and easily in full color nowadays and just distribute it and sell it yourself. And places like Image Comics, I think Image Comics is pretty much, they don't pay you, but you get paid based on sales. So you're pretty much drawing the comic for free, and if 4 months in it starts selling a lot of copies, then you start making money. But it's just you're putting in your own time. So at least that's a place where you wouldn't have to pay for that, for all the startup costs, if they like your work. Yes?
Where did you get your first break? You mentioned when you were in college and you were mailing out lots of things.
Well, the first things were right here in Chicago. I think, well, it's been a lot of my work published, but it was like for comic book fanzines or things that didn't pay, which were still a lot of fun. But my first paying job, I believe, was that piece for Playboy. And that was when I was 19 or so. And then it went on. Luckily, I was getting a lot of work doing advertising stuff and comic book and magazines and the like. Thank you very much for having me here. I had a great time.